I see. Okay, here comes the link. Well, hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the Wow! Ask the Pheo Para Superhero Whizzes, a Q&A session of the Pheo Para Alliance virtual conference. There will be a link soon for you to, in your native language, but I don't see that yet. Okay, it's coming. While that's coming, I'll introduce myself. I'm Lisa Anderson, and I'm a caregiver, and I got involved with the Pheo Para Alliance when my college-age son went on a very long five-year journey of trying to get diagnosed with Pheo. We didn't know what it was, but the symptoms were classic, and they were missed a lot until we finally figured it out. So once I discovered Pheo Para Alliance, it's been the perfect place for me to help others hopefully avoid the journey that we went through, and put some of my anxiety about this disease to a really good use. So I love being involved. And I'm here with Dr. Fishbein. I don't think Dr. Pacak is here yet. We're waiting for him. Oh, hi, Stephanie. Waiting for Dr. Pacak. Dr. Patel is here. Dr. Clifton-Bligh and Dr. Mittra, who I will properly introduce in a minute. But first, a few housekeeping things that I'll just try to get through and so we can get right to our questions. This program is brought to you by the Pheo Para Alliance, whose mission is to empower patients with pheochromocytoma or paraganglioma, their families and medical professionals through advocacy, education, and research. And we have some researchers here, and a global community of support while helping to advance research that accelerates treatments and cures. Special thanks to Progenix and Advanced Accelerator Applications for making this conference possible. Wonderful. Before we get started, I wanted to mention our Pheo Para Awareness Week, which is going on right now. As you can see in my background, I've got it up this week. We've got another day tomorrow. So most of the social media things live have happened, but you can still change your background or tweet on social media, or not tweet, you can share on social media, and just keep the word out there and let as many people know as possible that we might be rare, but we're not that rare, and it's a very important and impactful disease. So keep sharing as you can. So today our agenda is very simple. We're just going to spend the hour answering questions, which I love. It's my favorite thing. And then the link is here, so I'm going to try to share it. I don't know if I need to, but I'm going to put it in the chat window for you. See if that will. Oh, Amy, there it is. Maybe. Can you make sure that everybody has the link, Amy and Stephanie? Oh, hi, Dr. Pacak. There he is.
Hi, how are you? I finally
I'm well. Me. Nice to see you. So we're going
to get you. Did not arrive to my email. You know.
Oh,
so
no. Hi. Technology. Yeah. Well, we'll get through it.
You know, some, you know, Ben, you know, that link. I don't know. Who knows?
Well, we're happy to have you. I was teacher during COVID and had to learn how to do this Zoom with lots of breakout rooms and kids, and sure. Whew, it was a steep learning curve. So I hope some of it transfers to today. So a quick disclaimer that the information we have today on this webinar is just for educational purposes only and should never substitute for the advice of your doctors or medical team, since they have the in-depth knowledge of your medical history and current situation. The content of this program is not influenced by any of our sponsors or supporters. And now the good part, I get to introduce you to our experts for this session. I'm not going to read their bios because it would take me an hour to read a bio probably on each of them. So I'm just going to give you the quick version. Dr. Fishbein is Associate Professor of Medicine at the University of Colorado School of Medicine in the Division of Endocrinology, Metabolism, and Diabetes, with a secondary appointment in the Department of Biomedical Informatics. Glad you're here. Dr. Rory Clifton-Bligh is Associate Professor and Head of the Department of Endocrinology at Royal North Shore Hospital and Conjoint Associate Professor in Medicine at the University of Sydney. Glad you're here. all the way from across the world. It's wonderful. Dr. Karel Pacak is the senior investigator in the section of medical neuroendocrinology at the NIH in Bethesda, Maryland. And Dr. Neil Patel is assistant professor of neurotology and skull-based surgery within the division of otolaryngology, head and neck surgery at the University of Utah in Salt Lake, Utah. And finally, Dr. Erik Mittra is professor of diagnostic radiology and chief of nuclear medicine and molecular imaging at Oregon Health and Science University, in a neighbor close to Washington. Okay, now we get to move to the Q&A. And I will see what do we have here. Maybe I need to change this. I don't see any questions yet. So
that's easy.
Yeah, I know. Let's just visit. Maybe I'm just on one person. Let me go to everyone. I think I'm just seeing Amy. So let me see if everyone has questions. Okay. All right. Well, here's one that we've got that we can just start with for someone. How about the exciting news about, I hope I can say this, Beltuzafan? Did I say that right? Beltuzafan? Does anybody want to talk about the news with that?
Karel.
Yeah, so Beltuzafan, you know, is interesting drug, you know, that is actually introduced by Peloton and then, you know, transferred to Merck. This is the drug that is actually inhibiting HIF2 alpha, hypoxia inducible factor 2 alpha, is actually inhibiting dimerization. That is actually what is claiming. I'm not absolutely sure whether this is the action, but right now the dimerization of alpha and beta, you know, the subunit. So what is important that some patients with pheochromocytoma paraganglioma, especially those who have actually tumors that belong to cluster one. If we talk about the cluster one is something that is related to, for example, Krebs cycle, for example, succinate dehydrogenase or fumarate hydratase, or, you know, hypoxia signaling pathway, including, for example, VHL. So those patients actually have upregulation of HIF, and therefore, you know, if the belzutifan is used, can actually decrease the HIF can actually help patients to deal with the tumors, because we know that HIF, if it is actually, for example, dimerized and it cannot be removed by proteasome because there is some, for example, pathogenic mutation, or there is some defect like in SDHX patients that they have a high succinate and inhibiting prolyl hydroxylases, if it goes into actually the nucleus and affecting genes that are actually participating in tumorogenesis. So it's the drug that is definitely useful in some patients. I don't think that it will be useful in other patients or all patients. Those patients should be very well selected. Although I think the Merck, you know, opened a clinical trial for all patients, for example, with metastatic disease or aggressive tumors, whether they are belong to cluster one or cluster two. For our actually patients, cluster two is, for example, related to MEN or, you know, for example, neurofibromatosis one and other gene mutations. I should say that this is pretty well tolerable drug. You know, the adverse or side effects can be anemia. They can take the pills PO. So it's, and as I said, it's pretty well tolerated. The problem is, that is experimental drug. You know, the clinical trial was open at many places, not only in the US, but outside the US. And the study is almost to be over because there is a limit how many patients can be actually enrolled in those study, in this study. And I think is the number is 80. They already have a 65 or 70 patients. So there is actually only a small number of patients who could be enrolled in this in that study, whether it's in US or outside the US.
Right. Thank you. That's super helpful. Does anybody else want to jump in or want me to go to a new question? Good. All right. We did get sort of a theme on COVID. So we're having some questions about the impact of COVID on patients who've had, who have pheo para, especially like some long haul. Let's see. Are the docs seeing any new data or working on studies related to those with pheo para who have had COVID?
I can briefly start and answer that. I don't know anybody that's working specifically on this. We did put out a small survey just to see if COVID interrupted surveillance, screening, and follow-up for our patients with pheo para. And it looked like it did, as it did for probably everybody during the first 2 years of COVID. So we did do a short survey on that that was presented at a meeting this past year. But in terms of the effect of COVID directly on people with pheo para, I don't know if any of my colleagues know of anyone looking at that specifically. There's a lot of research on long haul COVID in general and the effects of COVID long term. Rory, I see you're unmuted, so maybe I'll pass over to you.
No, there was a paper out of New York about 12 months ago highlighting the problem of delayed diagnosis in pheo para with COVID, as Lauren's alluded to. It doesn't seem, at least in the small number of patients that have been reported in the literature, to affect the nature of the disease or its symptom presentation. But Lauren's exactly right. It certainly has created some havoc in delayed diagnosis.
Yeah, and I think that the patient should be aware that there are some, you know, the immunologic problems, you know, during the COVID, including interleukins, especially interleukin 6. And there are actually studies that they can actually or describe that those, you know, can affect the catecholamine release. And there are some studies, so usually case reports that, for example, patient with COVID and for example, functioning pheochromocytoma, which means that those that they are producing and releasing catecholamines can get worse. And therefore, you know, they, for example, the medication needs to be adjusted. We published a paper in Lancet, Diabetes and Endocrinology. What is the interaction between, for example, catecholamines and COVID? So if somebody is interested, you know, so it's very well summarized what actually patients with pheochromocytoma paraganglioma could expect, you know, if they have a COVID and what they have to do or, you know, how to approach, you know, this problem. And I will be very happy if there is any patient who may have COVID, you know, in the future, has COVID and would like to hear something more, you know, definitely to discuss with those patients, but I don't think that we need to discuss it during this hour because we don't have a time and it's a little bit complicated issue.
Okay, appreciate that. This is sort of circling back to the question about the name, belzutifan. How can I find out what cluster group my tumor is in the clinical setting? That was the last part.
I either Rory or Lauren or myself can answer, you know, it's pretty obvious, but maybe Lauren can, you know, comment about the clusters, you know, so I think that's pretty obvious, but, you know, she can
comment. So the clusters are largely defined by the hereditary DNA mutations or changes that someone might have. They can also be defined by the tumor itself and the expression of a number of genes from the tumor. So the easiest way in the clinical setting to understand which cluster the tumors might fall in is to know the germline hereditary genetic status. And so if that person had clinical genetic testing and they have a mutation or what we now call pathogenic variant in the DNA of certain genes, either NF1, RET, TMEM, that would put a person's tumors in one cluster. If they have SDH or VHL, DNA pathogenic variants or mutations, that would put the tumors in a separate cluster. Now, of course, not everybody has a hereditary mutation. It's very high percent of people who do who have pheopara. It can be somewhere between 30 to 35 to 40% of patients, but that means that there could be 60% of patients who do not have a known genetic predisposition for their pheopara. And in those cases, we don't necessarily know the cluster for sure unless we look at the tumors themselves. And most of us and most of the institutions we work at have biobanks where we can get pieces of the tumor at the time of surgery or afterwards and do research studies to try to figure out which cluster it's in. We can also take some guesses, educated guesses, where we can know that certain tumors in certain locations might be more likely to fall into certain clusters, but that's not a guarantee without our more molecular genetic kind of studies that we do in the laboratory.
And I think I would add to those guesses because I like what Lauren said. You know, so the other option is to look at, you know, the biochemical phenotype. If we talk about biochemical phenotype, what is the catecholamine or metanephrine that is increased? If you have, for example, norepinephrine, Europe, we say noradrenaline or normetanephrine, it's cluster one. If we have a tumors or, you know, scenario, there is increased epinephrine or adrenaline or metanephrine, most likely will be cluster two. So it's because sometimes the genetic testing, you know, cannot be actually obtained immediately. Some patients even cannot afford genetic testing, or there are some other problems, but usually we have the biochemical phenotype, you know. So it's not 100%, but it's pretty close, you know, to know whether I am in, for example, cluster one or cluster two.
Okay, thank you. So this question, it might need a little bit more clarification. It said, if you had a Pheo removed from your adrenal, then 3 years later, abdominal lymph nodes, it says, is possible that it won't return or more likely to return. I'm wondering if that's, if you see it in your abdominal lymph nodes, does that mean the Pheo is going to come back? I think that's probably what I'm looking for. So maybe more like predictors of spread, I guess. That might be a good.
Any of us can take it, but yeah. once we see that tumor has spread to lymph nodes, we do worry that there is an increased risk of recurrence again in the future and more sites of disease. It usually, again, nothing is 100%, so we can't comment on each person individually, but in general, if it's already spread somewhere, that suggests that there may be microscopic cells elsewhere in the body that we can't detect yet at this time, and they may at some point decide to grow and expand in the body. So certainly a person in this kind of scenario would need close follow-up to be watched and monitored for this to happen. That said, it could happen quickly. It could also happen 20, 40 years later down the road. We don't have the greatest ways to predict when or if it's going to happen, but certainly it increases our concern about it, and we should watch that person closely with surveillance.
Okay, thank you. So this person is wondering about getting a diagnosis. It says, if tumor has it been found on scan yet? I'm wondering if it has not been found on a scan, but maybe other indicators. So advice on getting a diagnosis.
I think it will go to Erik.
I think so. Mm-hmm.
I agree that it hasn't been found on the scan, so I'm out. I can't help.
Okay, so back to, yeah.
It depends what kind of scan, because there are scans that, you know, they will not give you, you know, positive results. And especially newcomers in scan, what, you know, Dr. Mittra is expert in, you know, so there are some good scans for pheochromocytoma paraganglioma. Maybe this is what, you know, somebody would like to know, which, you know, maybe scans, you know, to use.
That's a fair point. Yeah, thank you for that clarification. So it is true that there's a variety of different scans that can be used, as you're probably aware, including anatomical imaging, such as CT scans and MRI scans. And even within that, there's differences in quality of how those are performed. And then, as Karel was saying, there's also, you know, many functional imaging scans, such as dotatate PET scans, MIPG scans. And so it does matter, you know, if there's a very high chance that there is a tumor somewhere and you're not able to find it in a one scan, then it makes sense to try and do one of the other scans as well. So that's a great point.
Yeah.
But if I guess the question for the others, if you know, if truly you've used a few different approaches and you're not able to see it on a scan, what do you typically do at that point?
So it can become tricky then, because I would say if the biochemical elevation, the adrenaline hormones were really high, we would still have suspicion and we would try to look for places that aren't as easily seen on scans, like maybe a bladder paraganglioma, for instance, that sometimes can be difficult to image because even on the functional imaging, the dye goes through the bladder. And so sometimes it can be harder to see. If the biochemical testing, though, was negative and the scans are negative, then I would say that decreases the likelihood that there may be a tumor contributing to any symptoms that person has. Again, nothing's 100%, but that would be my general thinking in these scenarios.
This one might be a little more straightforward. It says, what sorts of heart issues can be caused by a Pheo that's secreting primarily epinephrine?
Maybe Rory will talk about that.
Yeah, no, it's a good question, because there are protean manifestations of the effect of epinephrine on the heart. So you can get heart failure, and you can get a classic form of heart failure, but more commonly we're seeing an unusual form of heart failure called Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. And it's important, and cardiologists by and large are very aware of this, that a small number of patients with Takotsubo cardiomyopathy will have undiagnosed pheochromocytoma as the cause of their presentation. Takotsubo has a very distinct appearance on cardiac imaging. So it's usually able to be distinguished from other forms of heart failure. But that's not the only kind of heart failure that patients with epinephrine secreting tumors can present with. So I've seen patients with, you know, classic myocardial infarction and pheochromocytoma, and patients with recurrent angina with pheochromocytoma. So the cardiac manifestations of this are really very diverse. And fortunately, the cardiologists have become super aware of this now, and it's pretty rare that somebody with, at least in my experience, with the cardiac presentation of a pheochromocytoma will not go unrecognized for long.
Okay, thank you. That's super helpful. How about, this sort of relates, how often is it recommended to redo metanephrine labs after a Pheo para removal?
So it really depends on the institution. We usually here at the NIH, we favor 4 to 6 weeks after removal. Okay. There are some institutions, and I think also European ones, that they usually can, you know, support to do it a little bit earlier, for example, 3 weeks after the operation. The only problem is, and I would not oppose that, the only problem is how the patient is feeling. If you have a major surgery and you still are taking, and I'm pretty sure that Neil, Dr. Patel, could comment about that. So the patient may not feel very well. They may still have a pain. They are not doing so well. They may have still some, even, you know, some nausea, sometimes a little bit, you know, because they are some people are more sensitive, you know. So I think it really depends how they do. If they are doing practically almost like normal way they did before the operation, possibly. But, you know, to be on safer side, I prefer 4 to 6 weeks after the operation, because I can tell you honestly, some patients, even, you know, with one tumor, they go through major surgery, and Dr. Patel can comment about that. They will lose kidney, they have this and that, and it's not easy and cannot be actually everything fixed. I mean, how they feel in a three weeks. So I like, you know, to be a little bit later on to make sure that there will not be false positive results, because what I'm talking about, if somebody has a pain, not feeling well, taking some medication, of course, you know, under stress, catecholamines go up, metanephrines can go up as well, and the patient will have false positive results. Everything costs money, especially in US, you have to pay, you know, for the test, you have to pay also to see the doctor. So it's also another financial burden on the top of the operation. So I think that would be my suggestion, but this is my personal view.
Okay.
And I agree with that.
Dr. Patel can comment about that.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think those points are really well taken. This individual may also be asking about, you know, how often to repeat it going forward, long-term. Mm-hmm. We, you know, there are a lot of moving parts of that. Number one is what are the actual clinical manifestations of the hypersecretion state? So how severe is the hypertension, or do they have any end organ effects, or is it just a seen on a lab test without really any significant symptoms? That's a big factor. And second is multicentricity. So if you have which tumor is the secreting tumor, and how many tumors are there that are likely to be secreting? We know that a very, very small number of head and neck tumors are hypersecreting, but it can happen, maybe 2 or 3% at most. And so we generally, you know, I'm speaking more as the head and neck surgeon here, but we generally will repeat them about every 6 to 12 months, depending on that clinical scenario. Because interestingly, I've had a patient who, when I was in training, who the only sign of their recurrence actually was biochemical. So it was just slowly kind of creeping up. And going back to the question about scans not being 100% sensitive and specific, the first sign of the recurrence, which was quite late, 8 or 10 years later, was biochemical and not radiographic. In the head and neck, after an operation, it's really hard to see recurrent or growing residual tumors. There's a lot of enhancement that's already there. Erik could comment too, but sometimes it's really hard to tell subtle differences over time. And so I think it is important really for a lifetime to check biochemical studies about every year.
Yep, and I just want to reiterate that what you just said at the end, I think, is the most important. So that this really should be done for life, and the interval might change depending on your particular clinical situation. But I would say at minimum for most people, at least once a year, maybe after a long time, a little less frequently, but again, for life.
Yeah. Don't go to sleep on this one. Yes.
There's one other lesser known fact about the effect of surgery on measuring catecholamines, and that is after you take out an adrenal gland, the epinephrine or adrenaline levels actually go down by about half. So the biochemistry labs don't know this, so they don't adjust their normal range. So it's just important to be aware, and it's only specific for removal of the adrenal gland, not for paragangliomas. But if you've had a pheochromocytoma resected, you should let your primary care physician know to be aware that the normal range for metinephrine metadrenaline is approximately half what it was before the tumor was resected. And I've had that problem before, where a recurrence of a tumor was missed because the elevation of the metadrenaline was still within the classic normal range without adjusting for removal of the adrenal gland.
That's a good tip. Thank you. Wow. So this one is for Dr. Mittra, and it's a question on a clinical trial for NeoRay radio. Let me see if I get this radio guard, and does it look like it might indicate treatment for SDHB GIST?
So this question is a little bit off topic, I would say, for Pheo para, but okay. I'll cover it just so that we're all on the same page, I guess. So this is talking about a clinical trial, which is in phase one, which means that it's an early phase trial called NeoRay. It's sponsored by Novartis. And basically, in our field of nuclear medicine, just like we have some of these current therapies like dotatate therapy and cassette therapy, all of those had to go through clinical trials to get to approval. And this is a new one that is being looked at. The target for this specific trial is something called GRPR, or gastrin-releasing peptide receptor, which is expressed in multiple types of cancer, including GIST, as is being asked here. And so many different sites in the United States and across the world are participating in this trial. We are as well at OHSU. And what I can say is, again, that it's very early on, but it's very similar to the clinical things that we do now, in that a patient will get a PET scan done to see if the target is expressed appropriately. And if so, they can then get the treatment with a different type of radioisotope binding to that same target. It's definitely too early to talk about any results. We're still just starting out enrolling patients and doing the treatments. But certainly if it is promising in this phase of the trial, then it'll continue on to phase two and phase three, and then ultimately to approval, but it's many, many years away from that.
Okay, thanks. A little sidebar, but I appreciate that.
Since yeah, we have and again, specifically, this one is not looking at neuroendocrine tumors.
Okay, good to know. Thank you. This one is for Dr. Patel. Can you talk about some of the risks associated with head and neck surgery for para?
Yeah, absolutely. So there, as you all know, there are three main types of head and neck paragangliomas: carotid body tumors, glomus vagali, and glomus jugulari or jugular paragangliomas. And the risks of surgery specifically for each of those do vary a bit. We'll start kind of low and go up, carotid body tumor being the lowest of the head and neck tumors. The main risks in carotid body tumor resection are number one to the carotid artery, and number two to the regional cranial nerves. And so these tumors by definition occur right at the junction of the external and internal carotid artery. And there's a classification system, the Shamblin classification, about how, not just how large the tumor is, but how much of the carotid artery it encases. And so as you go up in the grade of the tumor, one, two, and three, that involves more and more of the carotid. And what we found over the years is that the higher the Shamblin classification, the more likely you are to have a cranial neuropathy, because usually the tumor is larger and the regional cranial nerves, namely the vagus nerve, the accessory nerve, or the one that goes to the shoulder, and the hypoglossal nerve, or the one that goes to the tongue, those are very, very close to that tumor. In contrast, a very small carotid body tumor in our terms, it might be a centimeter, but that's a mile away from the cranial nerve in the head and neck. And so the risk goes down quite a bit. No matter what, the surgeon should be prepared to either have to bypass the carotid or patch graft the carotid. Very small ones can be removed without injuring the wall of the vessel. But the larger ones, I always would have a vascular surgeon or a neurosurgeon who's skilled in carotid grafts there in case that were to occur. As you go up, glomus vagali tumors are kind of right just about a centimeter below the base of the skull. And the main, apart from the risks that are sort of common to carotid body tumors and jugulary tumors for vagali, is the risk to the vagus nerve. So in general, again, this doesn't apply to everybody, we won't remove glomus vagali that's small if somebody has normal vagus nerve function. So if the vagus nerve has already stopped functioning on that side and the tumor is enlarging, then that may indicate a surgery. And the biggest sort of side effect or consequence of operating in that area is that even if you have a pre-existing vagal neuropathy, usually people have worse speech and or voice and swallowing afterward, even if they already have the pre-existing injury. So that's something to be aware of. And then sort of unique to the vagali tumors is that a lot of those cranial nerves that I mentioned, the 11th nerve, the accessory nerve goes to the shoulder, the 12th nerve, you have to add the 9th cranial nerve, the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is primarily another swallowing nerve, especially for sensation, that is at risk. And then probably the highest risk of all three of those are the ones that I deal with mostly are glomus jugulari tumors or jugular paragangliomas. And the reason is you add to all those cranial nerve risks, you add risk to hearing and facial nerve function. So these tumors by definition are centered or start right in the bottom of the middle ear cavity. So very close to the inner ear, the hearing and balance parts, and also usually less than a centimeter away from the facial nerve. And so that nerve can be at risk from the tumor itself or from the approach. So that's the main one I would add to that. And then vascular injuries at the base of the skull can be a little bit more challenging to deal with because you don't have the whole neck out basically. And so that's another situation where we're very cautious around the carotid artery as it ascends through the base of the skull.
Wow. Thank you for that. That's a complicated area there. So appreciate that. Maybe just sort of a add on to that. It says, if you've had a Pheo, what are the chances of getting a para?
It depends what is the background, especially genetic background. Of course, if you have a pheochromocytoma, it's related to some, you know, pheochromocytoma paraganglioma susceptibility gene that is known. And also it's related to the presence of paraganglioma S. Of course, you know, there is a chance that you can get the paraganglioma. It really depends on the mutation. If you go to cluster one, you know, that you will have, you know, less, much lower chance to get the paraganglioma. If you go, I mean, to cluster two, if you have a cluster one, you have a higher chance to get the paraganglioma, but lower chance to have a pheochromocytoma. Okay, so it really depends on the genetic background.
Okay, thanks.
And I just add for those without a genetic background, if you are tested and you do not carry one of these genes, and there's no family history, then your chance of getting a para after a Pheo is probably extremely low.
Yeah.
And Dr. Fishbein, if you have a Pheo and it's taken out, your adrenal gland's gone, and then later something shows up outside of your adrenal, like wherever, do you still call that a Pheo or is that called a para? Or is it a metastatic or a distant? Like, we get a lot of questions about that, and I don't quite get it.
It's a great question because sometimes we don't have the best answer for you until maybe after a surgery. So if a tumor forms inside the adrenal gland, we call it a pheo. If the tumor forms in one of the ganglia, which are little nerve bundles that run from the base of our skull, as we just heard about the head and neck, all the way down to the pelvis. And there are kind of areas where those are more common in the body. On those ganglia, it will be called a paraganglioma. If there is a lesion, a mass seen on imaging that we think is in a lymph node, sometimes that can be confusing to tell a lymph node in an abdomen from a paraganglioma. Exactly where in the abdomen is sometimes helpful to differentiate, but sometimes we don't really know until we can look, our pathology colleagues can look at it under the microscope to tell if there is lymph node tissue there or not. When lesions are found in lung or liver, they also can be a little bit difficult to tell. If they're truly primary paraganglioma that have formed in the lung or liver, or if they're metastases from some other tumor, pheopara, that was earlier. When they're in lung and liver though, we usually treat it as metastatic because we can't usually fully get rid of all of it. And so we kind of treat it the same, although there's a chance in the cluster one tumors, the SDHs, you can have primary paraganglioma in lungs and liver. But practically speaking, we usually treat that as metastatic because we don't know the difference unless we were really able to do some, you know, fine testing and looking under the microscope. When it's in bone, that's considered metastatic disease.
Okay.
So sometimes it's a hard answer to.
Okay, that makes me feel better.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So for maybe for patients, you know, so simplifying it, and I fully agree with Lauren. Everything what is in the lymph node or bone is metastatic, you know, by definition. Everything what is outside the bone and lymph node may be metastatic or may not be metastatic, okay? So usually if you see, you know, several lesions in the liver, in the lungs, most likely metastatic, okay? But, you know, so this is the new definition for WHO from 2017.
Okay, thank you, that does help. Thank you very much. So this question is, if you've had pheo or para, then recurrent paras, but you're negative on the standard genetic panel. They said Ambry or Invitae, should you pursue more comprehensive genetic testing?
Yeah, that's a great question. So if you had a pheo para and there's now metastatic disease, the majority of people, just over half who have metastatic disease, usually don't have a genetic variant known. So it is very common to have what we call sporadic metastatic pheo or para. That's so I wouldn't be surprised. And if you've had the general genetic testing that tests at least 12, if not 15 or more different genes, that's probably the best for now. If you, when you say recurrent, if you mean multifocal, so in different areas of the body that's not metastatic and not necessarily recurrence at the exact same site, but multifocal primaries, then there may be new research genes that we're discovering all the time that might play a role. And some of these new genes, especially in the last couple of years, haven't made it to the clinical genetic testing yet. So I tell all my patients that when their genetic testing is negative, to check back with me in 5 years, because there may be new genes that we can test for and look for that you, that that person may have that we weren't able to test previously. And then lastly, we'll defer to the research. There's always good reason if you're interested to be involved in giving blood or tumor samples to any of our multiple institutions around the world, really, that are doing research on this. And on a research standpoint, we may be able to identify other genes by more comprehensive testing. But standard for clinical testing, if you've had the full panel and it's negative, then most likely there's not a gene that we know of. again, with the caveats of if they're multifocal primaries or a strong family history of having it and still haven't found one, there's probably a gene we just don't have on that panel yet.
We began the session with a question on belzutifan. So I think Karel may want to discuss a very important exception to that rule about negative genetics, and that's when you don't have anything in the germline, but there's a very important genetic change in the tumor. Karel, do you want to, it's actually called the Pacak-Zweig syndrome, so you should talk to it.
Yeah, so as Lauren said, you know, it's important, you know, for the germline mutation, but also that, and that was the TCGA study that found practically the same percentage, you know, what is for germline mutation is for somatic mutation. If you don't find anything in blood, to simplify it for patients, you know, you may have something in the tumor, and this is called, you know, somatic mutation. And the somatic mutations are quite common. So it's between 30 to 40% of patients, they have a somatic mutation and they don't have a actually germline mutation that is usually, not always, but often is linked, you know, for example, to family history, that, you know something about the family that somebody had pheochromocytoma, paraganglioma compared to somatic mutations. And the somatic mutations are important. It's, you know, very common, for example, for VHL, neurofibromatosis, very, very rare, you know, for example, for cluster one tumors, like, you know, for example, except for VHL, and also, for example, succinate dehydrogenase, and it's also for HIF2 alpha, hypoxia induced bifactor 2 alpha. So, which belzutifan is very good, and you would not get, most patients would not have, you know, the germline mutation. So, I think that in the future, my feeling is, you know, why not to look at the tumors, of course, if the patient is operated, and then to go back to blood, you know, rather to do, you know, the blood testing, because if you do the blood testing, you will miss 50% of patients who will have actually mutation and who can profit from certain treatment, you know, whether it is, for example, RET oncogene, you know, some, there are some very interesting movement just now, you know, especially for the fusion genes, you know, what to do, you know, what kind of treatment to use, belzutifan for HIF2 alpha, and of course, you know, for, and as well as for example, for VHL. So it's really tricky a little bit. So the patient should know that if I don't have it in blood and if my tumor is removed, I should ask what is in my tumor.
Okay. But I just want to clarify that you're talking about potential treatments. That's different than hereditary. I'm just clarifying for the patients.
Yeah,
different than hereditary in terms of I'm going to pass this on to family members. So Dr. Pacak and Dr. Clifton-Bligh made great points. It's important to know the tumor mutations if you have multifocal or metastatic disease, because that may change treatment options. But this is a different scenario than what is going to be passed along in my family, which is just the blood testing.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you for that. It's really interesting. This person has been diagnosed with pheopara on a donatate PET, and they're wondering what it means when it says given location may represent organ of Zuckerkindel. And they're just wondering what that means.
I'm happy to take that initially. Anatomical reference. So the organ of Zuckerkindel is a collection of neural crest cells located right near one of the origins of the arteries that supply the abdomen. And so if we see a mass there on imaging, and it can be a donatate PET scan, but it could also potentially be just a CT or MRI, then just based on that location, it's thought to be originating from those specific neural crest cells. As Lauren described, there's all of these neural cells all along from the bottom of the head to the pelvis. And so this is just one specific location. I don't know if anybody wants to add anything to that.
It's slightly above the aortic bifurcation. And usually patients with organ of Zuckerkindel paraganglioma At least maybe about 30-40% of patients, they have, you know, some genetic background that is, you know, it's related usually to cluster one, you know, so pheochromocytoma / paraganglioma, here, of course, the paraganglioma. So just, you know, so if somebody has this type of tumor, they should always seek, you know, to get the genetic testing.
Perfect, thank you. This person has a question about, they have SDHD, like dog D, and they have an inoperable right side carotid body tumor. So are there any, what can be done? Is it surgery or radiotherapy? Are there any other possibilities for that?
I can start with this one. you know, there's a couple questions that, you know, I'd ask your treating provider, or if you're looking for other opinions, questions you could ask. One is, you know, what's actually defining it as inoperable? That's the probably question number one. And is that how much of the carotid artery is involved? If you've had what's called a balloon occlusion test, which is where we place a balloon through a catheter in the carotid and you fail that test, meaning you have neurologic changes, which would suggest that would be very risky to take out the tumor, or is it because of the risk to regional cranial nerves? If you've had a surgery for a glomus vagali on the right side, again, I'm making a presumption here, not knowing the whole story, but most of the time that means that the vagus nerve doesn't work on that side. And so it reduces a little bit of the regional cranial nerve risk of taking out the tumor. But the main, you know, the main kind of zooming out, seeing the forest from the trees questions would be age and what is the tumor actually doing and what's its growth rate been over time? And that's how I would make a decision about if it's going to be, you know, potentially a risky operative intervention or a non-operative approach like radiation. I always tell patients that radiation is not, it's something you wanna kind of keep in your back pocket. It's the ace in the hole that you don't wanna use too many times or too lightly because you usually only get one chance in the neck to use radiation. Sometimes you can do re-irradiate years later or radiate a different field, but generally speaking, once you do that, you've used that card, and any operation afterward is exceptionally more difficult, in particular in the neck. And so, so those are some of the questions I'd ask, and some of the considerations that would go into how to deal with that carotid body tumor. I can't really comment on belzutifan, but maybe somebody else could.
It was just quiet, so I was piping in with that. For the belzutifan, as Dr. Pacak said earlier, it's still in clinical trials for pheopara. So we, you know, unless the person had von Hippel-Lindau syndrome where it's approved for use, although it's really approved for the other tumors in VHL, but any VHL, probably we could get that covered. But otherwise, it's still clinical trials, so we would wait.
You can also use somatostatin cold analog, you know, so it's still not proven, but I can tell you, you know, based on our experience, it's working pretty well. And for example, you can use the lanreotide or octreotide, and a patient, they don't need to go through radiation. They will have, you know, this treatment usually every 3 or 4 weeks, you know, the treatment is expensive, but it depends on the insurance because most insurance companies are covering, at least this is my experience in the US, and the tumors can be stabilized and can be stabilized really very well. So it really depends, you know, what is there and what the patient would actually prefer, whether it would be radiation, you know, and Dr. Patel mentioned about it, belzutifan, cold somatostatin analog, or just, you know, to watch the patient wait and see, you know, that there are, you know, some changes and anything is happening. But of course, you know, this approach, you know, just, you know, to have repeated scans every, for example, 6 to 12 months, or sometimes 12 to 24 months, it depends on the tumor size and everything, you know, it's maybe a little bit disturbing, not only that this is pricey, but also, you know, there is, you know, certain component of anxiety.
Yeah, but I was going to say, if these head and neck tumors are not growing and not causing any symptoms, they're usually very slow growing tumors, and it's okay to do active observation. So I don't like to say wait and watch. I think it a little bit adds to the anxiety with that terminology sometimes, but I call it active observation. We're not ignoring this, but if it's not causing you symptoms and it's not growing, because there are so many nerves and complications potentially from surgery with the head and neck tumors, it is absolutely okay to do active observation for these with imaging every 6 to 12 months or so. And as Dr. Pacak said, it does add a lot of anxiety, I know, to know there's a tumor there that maybe you feel like you're not doing something for, but it's always a risk benefit of those complications in very difficult areas with lots of nerves and vessels. And so again, if the tumor's not compromising any of those nerves and vessels, and it's not growing, you have that opportunity to find out your best options, find out how quickly it is growing or not growing, and then make a good educated decision with your providers.
Yeah, I just want to echo what Stephanie or what Lauren said about natural history. That's an active area of research of mine, and stay tuned. Hopefully in the next few years, we have some good data on that, but it's probably been the biggest paradigm shift over the years. There was once a time where head and neck paragangliomas were considered radio resistant, where you couldn't radiate them and they would just stay viable and keep growing. And nowadays, even some of the original kind of bastions of paraganglioma surgery, the people who wrote the textbooks are changing their approach. And a more conservative approach, active observation, like Lauren mentioned, radiation in select circumstances is very reasonable. And you'd want to make sure whoever you're getting an opinion from that they have entertained all of those options.
Well, I promised we'd end on time, but Dr. Patel, we'll be following up with you for more information for downstream to put on our website. We appreciate the help you've given so far, as have all of you. Also, quick plug for the Prague conference in October, that there is a patient component, right? And I think there's going to be some virtual joining options. Is that right?
Yeah, I think that we, you know, so we will have some virtual option, you know, for patients who may not actually come to Prague, because Prague is, you know, located in Europe. It's long time, you know, COVID is still around, you know, some patients, of course, may not be able to travel for whatever the reason is. So we will have, you know, certain option, you know, to have, you know, this meeting either broadcasting as a live virtually, or, you know, after the meeting, we are still discussing, you know, the setup and all this, you know, logistic, you know, how to put everything together.
Well, we'll keep working with you and, you know, put out the information as best we can through the Pheo Alliance and different social media platforms. So we're looking forward to that. I want to say thank you to you all for your presentation. It's wonderful. Oh my gosh, we're so lucky to have your expertise and your dedication. I say this all the time. See that explosion in the back? My mind would explode without you experts and people who can help us take care of our patients and patients themselves. We're so grateful to you for your expertise and that you've decided to dedicate to this disease. Thank you. Like, I don't even have words for it. Thank you. Thanks to Progenix and the other sponsors for making this conference possible. This and all the sessions are going to be available on this platform. So you just have to re-log back in for our followers. And Awareness Week, we've got another day, so you could keep promoting us till tomorrow. And we also, this is, we're like, you guys are the closers. You close this whole week of, there's been so many sessions that have been incredible. And I just, we have the perfect team to close it out. So thank you all. And can't wait to see what the research yields and, you know, better diagnostics, better follow-up. All that is because of you guys, you physicians. So thank you so much. And Stephanie, did I miss anything? Am I good? Amy, anything else? Okay, so thanks everybody. Okay, and I think there may have been a few questions that didn't get answered, but we'll do our best. We've got a lot of videos on our website that address a lot of these things, from the trajectory of diagnosis through treatment, through genetics, follow-ups, long-term. So we've got the whole arc of information, and many of you are on those videos already. So take the time to go to our website, pheopara.org, and you'll find a lot of good information. So I think, oh my gosh, it's 1:30, or yeah, let's see, on the dot, we did it. Thank you. Anything else?
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having us. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right.
Bye. Thank you.
Do well. Stay healthy. See you in Prague.
Bye.
Bye-bye.